nice, isn't it? It's 6:30, slightly past. We'll call the meeting to order for City Commission meeting for El Dorado, March 21, 2016. Welcome, everybody. First thing on our order of business is invocation. Pastor Mark, lead us in invocation.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this privilege to be here tonight and gather and discuss the business of the city, and we pray for wisdom for the many issues that will be brought up. We pray for guidance that will lead to flourishing and growth and better life for our community. We pray that you help us to resolve good solutions to the things that are going to be discussed tonight, good steps forward. We pray for just the recognition that you are giving good gifts each day to us. Let us be thankful, and we pray for your wisdom and your help tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. All right, Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Moving on with our agenda, we have personal appearances. Jim Honey with AAA, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Mayor Haynes, commissioners, appreciate the opportunity to come back here. It's a real joy to be able to come to El Dorado and present a traffic safety award, AAA, to the community of El Dorado and the police department. I'd like to just first recognize Troy Wells here with the Kansas Department of Transportation. Troy really helps AAA around the state trying to identify possibly deserving police departments that might be deserving of the award, and identifies them, encourages them to make application for the award. So we really appreciate what Troy does to for the program. Its purpose is to encourage communities to address traffic safety issues in a cost-effective and coordinated way. And law enforcement agencies are recognized for their work in traffic safety education, enforcement, engineering, emergency medical services work. And El Dorado Police Department is one of only 23 police departments across the state that's qualifying for an award for 2015, and one of only 10 police departments to qualify for the Gold Award. They're being recognized for their effective participation in the state's most successful teen seatbelt usage improvement program called SAFE, with the El Dorado High School and grade schools, for their child passenger safety inspection stations at the Walnut River Festival, and the highly effective clicketer ticket, impaired driver deterrent, and commercial vehicle high visibility enforcement programs. They're also being recognized for obtaining community input from a traffic safety committee, where they involve more than just their own organization, but others, and they meet regularly to do that. And they also are being recognized for having a seatbelt policy that they adhere to in their department. The evidence of the effectiveness of their gold level work is borne out in their traffic safety statistics. adult seatbelt use is above average here, 83%, while seatbelt use in the schools is at 91%, 2 years running, so doing even better than the adults. Accordingly, over the most recent 3 years, available statistics, alcohol crashes have been cut in half from 10 to 5, crash injuries have dropped from 83 to 57, and fatalities have dropped from 2 to 0. And more impressively, there have been 0 fatalities in 4 of the last 5 years. The Gold Award is given to communities that implement programs and projects that demonstrate superior efforts to address local traffic safety issues, and that's what these statistics, I think, have borne out. So I first want to thank each of you for the leadership and the support that you give the police department. It's without that, they wouldn't qualify for the award, and so we appreciate that very, very much. And it's a really distinct pleasure to be able to present Chief Kurt Zeman and Sergeant John Thompson and the rest of the men and women of the police department with the 2015 AAA Community Traffic Safety Gold Award. So, Chief.
Thank you. I have next on our personal appearances, Steve Moody, fire chief for fire department annual report.
To give you an overview of the fire department's operation this past year, how do I describe the El Dorado Fire Department? I describe the department as a small group of dedicated professionals consisting of paid members, volunteer members, and student interns. A proud group that has the mantra, pride in service. I would also describe the department as one that does more with less. This evening, I'll give you a snapshot of what the fire department did this past year. We'll talk about response times, fire loss, accomplishments, major purchases, response types, inspections, public education, volunteer, and training and events. So stop me if you have any questions. This past year, like many before, was a busy one for the El Dorado Fire Department. The year saw some members leave and likewise new members that joined the fire department family. The year saw equipment maintenance as expected which produced an increase in reliability of equipment. We've been able to share our accomplishments as well as our challenges with the public through the website and Facebook pages. Through the excellent photos of professional photographer Chad Wittenberg, as well as helmet camera video that captured the department in action. Our response times have gone up slightly. This is mostly due to how we record our on-scene arrivals. Instead of registering our on-scene time as the first unit, we register the scene as the second unit when both crews, because that's the time when we can make an entry. This slide shows our total loss and our total saved. This does not include wildland properties that were saved. Numerous ones there that we could add to that number. The El Dorado Fire Department is one of a few departments that generate funds. The department provides fire protection for El Dorado Township at a revenue generation of $549,445. Hazmat coverage for the entire county generating $16,000, and fire protection to Prospect Township generating $42,560 for a grand total of $608,005. Two major purchases have been placed recently. The first is our 100-foot aerial ladder truck. This truck will allow us to make rescues and gives us an overhead water protection system. On April the 18th, the commission meeting night at 6 o'clock before this meeting, we'll have an open house, a christening and ribbon cutting ceremony for the new truck. So I invite all you commissioners, mayor, and all the citizens of the community to come out and take a look at their newest piece of apparatus.
That's a really cool ceremony too.
And it's a beautiful truck, too. It really is. We had one for our engine 10. So we'll have another one of them coming up on April the 18th at 6 o'clock. A second purchase is our training tire. We'll no longer need to train exclusively on demolition homes, which has been what we've done in the past. The tire will allow us to train on multiple facets: sprinkler systems, standpipes, roof cutting, ceiling pull-down, rappelling, and confined space. We are partnering with Butler Community College on this project. The college is covering the cost of the structure, and we, the city, are handling the land, plus the infrastructure, including the concrete piers for structure mounting, running a fire hydrant, installing roadways on both sides of the facility, and bringing in electricity. This is going to be a tremendous resource for both the college and for us at the fire department. Maintenance is another area where the fire department excels. Over 244 hours time was logged by firefighters conducting maintenance on trucks. Michael Rose is our lead on maintenance, and he's as good a mechanic as you'll ever find anywhere. This brought us the equivalent in savings of $30,000. The only major truck expense this past year was Quint One's waterway. And I might add that the company who built our Quint is no longer in service. So it did really difficult to get parts for that truck. And that's the one where the ladder tire comes in to replace. We responded to 657 calls for service from Station 1, 467 from Station 2, 80 calls from El Dorado Township, 63 from Prospect, and 31 Mutual Aid, for a grand total of 1,298 responses. And that pie matrix there on the overhead there shows the fires at 153, medical at 749, hazardous materials at 81, service calls 52, good intent calls 179, and false alarms at 75. Our goal with inspections and public education is to reduce the number of fires. We try to inspect all the commercial properties on an annual basis. Original and follow-up total 701. A new prevention program is a door-to-door, everybody has a smoke detector program. Lieutenant Kobe Spear is spearheading that program. Crews will be instituting various methods to get the word out, and the Red Cross is providing all the smoke detectors that we need. Fire department flow test all the city's fire hydrants. We added a secondary inspection to bring us in alignment with ISO Insurance Service Organization, who rates fire departments, and they give you an added incentive if you inspect them twice a year. So we did that this past year. Public education included a Project 2020, which is a mentoring program, junior firefighter program, fire extinguisher training, fire safety talks, and fire prevention week. And as you can see, we have Sparky the fire pup helping send the message, and he joined us last year. Student residents. We get an invaluable service from our college interns. Once these student residents get their Firefighter 1 certification, they can serve as a firefighter for us. It's a win-win situation. The student gets real life experience, and the city of El Dorado gets firefighters at a minimal cost. Training hours totaled 2,038 this past year. Some highlighted ones were the Kansas State Firefighter Association Conference, Hazardous Materials Technician, specialized classes through Kansas University, Advanced EMT, refinery training at Texas A&M, covered by Holly Frontier, and three people to the National Fire Academy. The cost of that was picked up by the federal government. And the events, there were many too. It was the El Dorado Fire Department's 130th birthday party last year. We do the annual Muscular Dystrophy Association boot drive, Elks Flag Day, El Dorado Fall Festival, OK Kids Camp, Trick or Treat downtown, YMCA Kids Camp, Butler 4-H, Wichita 911 Stair Climb. And I might add there, I just had a request from Wichita that we would, for their stair climb this following year, that we would bring our ladder up and hang the American flag off of it for their ceremony. There's a picture of all the firefighters. Firefighters spend a third day of their lives at work, missed birthday parties, missed holidays, missed anniversaries. Firefighters do what they do because they love helping others. Our mantra is pride and service. It is how we do what we do. Every one of us signs a pledge of service, pledge and service pledge. As the chief of the El Dorado Fire Department, I thank City Manager Herb Llewellyn. I thank you, commissioners. I thank you, Mayor. And most importantly, I thank the citizens of El Dorado.
Well, thanks.
Thank you
very much. Any questions for Chief Moody?
Very good.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chief.
I have Gene Plummer next on my personal appearances. Gene?
My name is Gene Plummer. I live at 1121 Douglas Road. Every year, the Alumni Association of El Dorado High School honors an alum that has given outstanding service to the community. Thanks for letting us make that recognition at the City Commission meeting. Well, thanks for arranging this. This year's honoree attended El Dorado schools from the second grade to graduation. He and his high school sweetheart graduated that same year. He went on to college at the University of Kansas, where he obtained a degree in architecture. This was probably the clue to his identity, but if that didn't do it, some of his contributions to this community include selection of Leadership Butler, Leadership Kansas, past president of Kiwanis, SBA Hospital Board president, and twice the president of El Dorado Inc., and president of the local United Way. His leadership roles and training were the catalyst to prompt him to run for El Dorado mayor. Tonight, the EHS Alumni Association would like to honor Mayor Vince Haynes as the Alumnus of the Year, but wait, there's more. What else has he done for our community? Vince was instrumental in bringing power grid engineering to El Dorado. He worked diligently to get BG Products Company to locate here. He designed the BG Products Veterans Stadium. He was the partnership architect for the new Skelly and El Dorado Middle Schools, and with his wife, Melody Schloss Haynes, he attends EHS music and sporting events to show support for the students and their activities. His parents created the mindset of the importance of education. His dad, Gerald Haynes, taught at Lincoln Grade School and was principal at all the other grade schools here. His mother, Elsie, was the administration assistant for the Special Education Co-op for USD 490. Vince and Melody have one daughter, Laura Jansen of Bartlesville, Oklahoma, sons Samuel, a junior at KSU, Wesley, a freshman at WSU, and Adam, a freshman at EHS. In addition to being our mayor, Vince is a partner in Gravity Works architectural firm. Please help us honor this 1985 graduate of El Dorado High School, so deserving of this honor as EHS Alumnus of the Year. And Mary Maloney is going to present the award, and I think we have a group of people here that you were probably going to recognize.
Wow, yes. Well, I hardly know what to say, but thank you. It's an honor to be up here. It's an honor to be in this community. We, Melody and I, some 24 years ago, decided to come back to El Dorado, and it was a great decision, and it's a great place to raise our children, a great foundation, and we El Dorado schools, all with my father Gerald and mother Elsie working in them, certainly dear to my heart. So I don't know what to say, but thank you so much. I appreciate it. This is I'm humbled. Thank you. Wow, do we have to keep going?
We're done.
We're done?
You're the mayor. You're on.
Okay. Next on our agenda is public comment. Anybody in the audience wishing to address the commission? As you address, I will lay out a couple of ground rules associated with public comment. Please state your name and address. You don't need to be a resident. Please limit to 5 minutes. If you need more, then the commission can offer some more. Questions directed to the city commission, please follow decorum policy. Debate or arguments not allowed. It's not that kind of comment. Can not address legal issues, and any violation of that can get you removed here. So I appreciate that. Welcome.
My name is Lonnie Snook. I feel a little bit honored because I went to school with your dad. I live at 3998 Northeast Coal Creek Road. And I'm here because you are the elected body charged with looking out for the interest of El Dorado and its residents. And the positioning of the gun range on the water's edge at El Dorado Lake could be on the brink of damaging one of the finest recreation facilities in the state of Kansas in many ways. People don't realize it, but I live on the east side of the lake, and I can hear people talking and playing music on the west side of the lake. Water does transfer noise. We wonder how sound from a shooting range magnified across the water will affect residents, campers, and those that are here for water sports. I question if there's ever been an environmental study or statement on the effect of wildlife and home values in the area. I was promised this information from the county commissioners, but I have not received it yet. More critically, it will introduce lead into an environmentally sensitive area related to our wildlife and our water supply. Just what are the long-range plans? Are we going to add another trap chute later on? Are we going to continue to add noise to the area? This is a wildlife area. My wife and I spent a great deal of time in Montana. She was employed by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. We are not anti-gun in any way, shape, or form. We are very much pro-gun, pro-wildlife, fishing, hunting, and camping. However, we see this as a deterrent to all of these, and I feel certain that this range will be heard throughout the entire valley that made the lake possible. Sounds don't move in a linear manner. They are dynamic and they move within landforms. There's a residence of a Mr. Johnson located within 500 feet of the proposed range. I met Mr. Johnson for the first time tonight when we walked in and shook hands. I had talked to him on the phone briefly. But I feel for him, and I feel for all the other people who live near this range. You see, we're all Mr. Johnson, and we all benefit or suffer from actions taken by a few. The lake and the campgrounds are not a facility that is owned by the Wildlife and Parks or the Corps of Engineers. It's owned by us taxpayers, and we hire them to do our bidding. I think we may have an organization that possibly could be out of control. I believe that this is inside the area of El Dorado's zoning and planning control, and I wish to ask the city of El Dorado to determine the correct spatial zoning and the appropriateness of this facility at this location. I'm asking you as our elected commissioners to examine this project, to make sure that it is right for the people who live in the area and the people who use the lake, the wildlife, which must be protected, and all of Butler County. I would like to thank you in advance for the time and for what I hope that you will try to do for us. I'll answer any questions you have. If you have
any questions? I don't. I want to thank you very much for that. I would, I guess, ask and direct staff if you had a chance to learn more about this and what kind of direction have you taken.
And I guess from my perspective, I've just learned about it reading the stories in the paper. And so hadn't given it much consideration other than what I read in the paper. Here in the last week or so, I've been several people, including Mr. Snook, has asked about it. And so we've talked about it internally and do think it's under our area of influence. But our normal course of action, if someone wants to do something within the 3-mile boundary that we is our area of influence, they'll start with the county. The county will send them to us. That did not occur in this case, and so that's how we normally become involved in an issue like this, is the county sends someone to us. Again, because we've never been notified officially, we haven't engaged the county in an official manner.
Are we bound by that, by statute?
I don't understand your question.
Do we have to wait until we're invited in by the county to get involved? And
probably not. I think that what I wanted to make sure that you were aware of this issue, and then if you wanted, you'd direct staff to contact the county, ask how a determination, if a determination was made. And that's how we'd get involved in it. But we wouldn't have to be, but that's normally how it occurs.
I'm like you. I didn't know much about it other than what I'd read in the local newspaper and a couple things I've heard on the street. Other than that, officially, I had no news of it other than that.
I think it all kind of sneaked up on all of us, and all of a sudden we saw dirt moving and said, what is that next door? And that's what it was.
So we have a project that's under construction out at the lake, and I guess I would, direct the staff to, do you need a vote of 3 for that direction?
If you just if the consensus this sounds of the commission, like what you want, then that's fine.
We certainly want to make sure that all the proper procedures were followed, and would direct staff to follow through with that. Make sure.
I concur.
We'll do it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anybody else wish to address the commission?
I'm glad that Mr. Snook addressed you so well. and that he touched on so many important things. So I won't repeat them.
Sir, could you state your name and address, please?
My name is Fred Madlener, M-A-D-L-E-N-E-R. And my address is 5101 Northeast Coal Creek Road. I live practically on the lake. My boundary is a very small one, which is between the lake and my fence. It's at the top of the lake. So I'm interested in the doings of the lake, and I'm astonished at how many people come to the lake on the holidays. Sometimes it's an absolute traffic jam up there. This particular project, it seems to me, would have benefited from having a public hearing. And it turns out that there may have been one that was called, but the print was so small in the newspaper that it was printed in that nobody saw it. And that I sympathize with your colleague who didn't see it, and I didn't. All I knew that it was going on was that the earth moving equipment was there grubbing up the earth to do something. And inquiring into that, we found out that it's a firing range. That location that they picked, that the state has agreed to use, and I suppose they consulted the Army Corps of Engineers, because it is basically Army Corps of Engineers land that has been leased to the state, is within our purview as planners. And it's a shame that we didn't have a public hearing. That, well, maybe they had a public hearing, but if it's a public hearing that nobody has gone to, it's you have to leave out the public from it, because there was no public there to send it on. And the reason why it's important to have public hearings is that the public, if you think about it, knows more about our land than the officials that nominally take care of it. Because if you add up the knowledge that all of us have and you consult us or tell us what you're going to do, the public can have input into something and alert the authorities that there are some problems. And it's a good thing for them to know about the problems before they get engaged in it and call in the earth movers. So we may be late, but I can see that you are going to try to inquire as to how this scooted past without us knowing about it. It is a planning matter, and that is going to be the resolution. The planners have to agree to it. But it, just off the top of our heads, I think we can admit that it's probably a very inappropriate spot that they've chosen. It may have been cheap, because they got the land for nothing, but it's going to be expensive in the sense that it is a sort of industrial use of our land that is being built right next to where thousands of people try to camp out and enjoy the nature and the lake. So it doesn't look like it's a very appropriate use of public land. And that may be the key to the fact that they really didn't want to talk to anybody about it before they did it. So I add my voice to that of the previous speaker, who ably covered the issues, and hope that you will proceed to inform yourselves as to how this got under the radar somehow or another. It even escaped the professionals who are watching things like that. And I think that when you examine it, you will concur with some of us who live in the area that it's an unwelcome addition to our area. because the lake is very nice, very worth protecting, and this certainly doesn't do that. And I add my voice to that of Mr. Schnucker, who says, what are we going to do about the lead that is in the bullets that are going to be shot out in 50 firing lanes? That could probably take care of all the gun users of Kansas. 50 firing lanes. So please pursue this, and we appreciate your interest in it.
Thank you.
I got one question for you, Herb. Is that government land or is that city land?
It is owned by the Corps of Engineers. It is under a long-term lease with the state of Kansas Parks and Rec or whatever, and our wildlife.
Is it owned by the U.S. government?
Yes.
Can we tell the U.S. government what they can do and what they can't do?
The laws of the state of Kansas. No, I'll back up. The laws of the United States of America recognize zoning. It's been vetted through the Supreme Court on many occasions, and is the law behind zoning is absolute as much as anything can be. So yes, the state of Kansas gives cities the authority to enter into agreements with the county like we have on this extraterritorial. And we have an interlocal agreement with the county of Butler. So all of the legal things that allow you to have this conversation, I believe, have been taken care of. I guess that what I'm hearing isn't as much about is what happened legal as much as why didn't our government want to hear our voice? And so that's a whole nother question. So what they're asking isn't necessarily was it done illegal, but shouldn't we get to talk about this? It's next to us and no one came to visit with us. And as the city of El Dorado actually abuts it, the city owns the bowl the water's all in. So we're a next door neighbor and we weren't consulted. I think that for me, I'm way too early to recommend we go to the courts to resolve this. I think the first is to ask the county about it and then the state as well. And I think the thing I've heard is from people is they want to discuss it, and that public hearings are a good thing. And so I guess as an example, a year ago, we had a zoning request or special use in our extraterritorial jurisdiction. And there were three public hearings for that, one before the City of El Dorado's Planning Commission, one before the County Commission of Butler, and one before the City Commission. And so what we're being asked about public hearings is, in our normal way of due process for this extra territory, you get three public hearings. And so the people impacted get to come and visit with both appointed boards and elected boards.
Yeah. You never received a letter at all from anybody?
No, sir. No. And I haven't met anybody who did. But I do know that the park ranger went visiting the very proximate people. But I don't know what he said to them. We have somebody in the room, Mr. Johnson, who is very near there. His is the first house within 500 feet. And a friend told me that he had been visited, but I don't know what transpired in the conversation.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good day. My name is Kevin Johnson, 482 Northeast Blue Stem Road. I have a house that is on the corner of Shade Creek Access and Boostum Road, which is the closest house to the 70 gun range. 2 years ago, we were visited by a park ranger, Steph Turner is his name, and he presented a proposal of a gun range to be placed around 500 feet from my house. And my wife and I both at that time were very much so against it. He did come back, I think, one other time to talk again. At that time, he did bring some papers, some prints, in that he was going, they were going to pattern off of the Hillsdale Lake gun range, firing range, up at Paola, Kansas. All no blue sky and all that. And there was no other discussion other than one time he came by and actually asked our opinion again about it, and we were definitely against it. The whole time I told him we'd do whatever we could to stop it. That's the last conversation we had over 2 years ago. Like I said, I'm right on the corner. I never received a letter, a phone call about any type of a meeting or anything that we could do to rebut it or to discuss it. And I'm very discouraged and dissatisfied with the way it was handled. I don't think it was professional. In fact, I think it was unethical. And appreciate whatever you can do to look into it, and appreciate your concern. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, you've got direction. We'll
yes, sir.
Find out what we can find, learn what we can about it.
We'll report back?
Report back, yeah. Okay. Thank you, everybody. Anybody else wishing to address the commission? Seeing none, we'll close public comment and move on the agenda. consent agenda. Everybody's had a chance to see the minutes from a previous meeting. Any questions or comments associated with the consent agenda? I will entertain a motion to...
I move that the consent agenda as presented be approved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 4-0. Next on our agenda would be application to rezone lots 5, 6, and 7 of the Legion 2nd Edition from R1 low density residential to C1 Central Business District.
Yes, Mayor, the American Legion is requesting this zone change. At the February 25th Planning Commission meeting, this case was heard and a public hearing was held. The Planning Commission decided to break their votes into three separate by lot. The map in front of you show lot 5 and 6. Which are requested to be rezoned to C1. And the map, the drawing here below, lot 7, the hatched area, is also was requested to go to C1. Lots 5 and 6 were unanimous 6-0 vote, and lot 7 was split vote 5-1.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions from the commission?
Is this going to have any interference with the Haverhill beautification project?
There's right-of-way existing, but this is reason. This is more about what's allowed use on the
right.
property.
But I mean, if they do build on lot 6.
I mean, whoever would be the potential owner of that lot would own that property. The city does have an easement along there in right of way.
And so the lot six specifically, we're not putting anything in because this is up in the air and probably sold. We're not going to do any more work until it's resolved. The potential buyer has visited with staff about landscaping. And so we're want to work in partnership and not get ahead of this. So we have, that's the only reason we haven't planted stuff, because this has kind of been imminent, the sale.
The beautification project is primarily along the right-of-way
yes.
of Haverhill.
And then, they have a complete plan for the EFABC in and around the stadium, and that'll be a whole nother EFABC discussion.
What's the ordinance number going to be?
G-1215.
Okay. If that any further questions, we've got possible actions that we can take to approve, to return, approve it as submitted, return to the Planning Commission or to overrule. I will entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move to approve case number 16003 REZ, requesting the rezoning of lots 5, 6, and 7 of the American Legion 2nd Edition in Eldorado, Kansas to C1 General Business District be accepted, and that ordinance number G1215 be approved.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and second. Any further discussion? Roll call then.
Mayor Haynes?
Yes.
Commissioner Lewis?
Yes.
Commissioner Badway?
Yes.
Commissioner Wilkinson?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for those in the audience for American Legion and your efforts here. This is a good step. Next on our agenda is application to rezone 1237 and 1239 West Central from R1 low density residential to C1 central business. Scott, do you have more?
Yes, Mayor. At the February 25th Planning Commission meeting, a public hearing was held. A vote of 3-3 was cast by the Planning Commission. So that comes to you all with no recommendation. The applicant is requesting this the current R1 zoning to be rezoned to C1. Staff feels it meets with our future land use map and our comprehensive plan. I stand for any questions.
Okay. Is there anybody from the audience who wish to address the commission on this?
I'm Judy Starrett. I live at 105 Ray Street, which is right around the corner, the second house from West Central. I didn't speak during public comment because I assumed I'd have an opportunity to speak now. I apologize if I'm out of order and not having spoken earlier. So what I wanted to say is the far west end of Central is a busy commercial strip with lots of fast food restaurants, gas stations, and small businesses, with a lot of traffic, including delivery trucks. El Dorado has done a really good job of segregating the commercial strip to the far west end of West Central, and in particular, west of Poplar Street. There is commerce at the intersection of West Central and Poplar, but that's consistent with the comprehensive plan, which envisions that you'll have businesses at the intersections of major arterials. But it doesn't contemplate that then can be bootstrapped to add commercial properties adjacent to those. Expanding commerce between that intersection is a whole other issue, and there should not be any presumption that the adjacent properties are automatically eligible to be reclassified. Over time, it's indisputable that the commercial strip will eventually go all the way to Main Street. That's going to happen over a long period of time. I understand that. I expect that. So the question that I pose is whether or not this request is premature. whether this is the right time and in the interest of public safety and in the interest of the city to do it now. And our concerns, my husband could not be here, he's out of town, our concerns of prematurely extending the commercial strip further east include the following. First of all, there's no need for more commercial property on West Central Avenue at this time. There's lots of vacant lots, lots of vacant business buildings. You just approved three more lots for commercial use. It's not fair to the property owners of all those vacant lots and properties that can be used for commercial uses to dump two more lots onto the market when there's no really need for it. And it's going to have a detrimental effect in ways that I'll explain. There's a shortage of affordable housing in our city. This commission has often recognized that. And so now we have two residential properties. The background, as far as I know, it is in 2003, the properties were inherited by a woman who lives in Oklahoma. So my understanding, based on my observations, that there's never been any real effort to rent the houses or to sell the houses. A very feeble effort was made to sell the house a few years back, but it was not a true effort. So instead, the properties have remained vacant over time, and now they, I'm told, they look fine on the outside, but I've been told that they're not in good condition on the inside. There's some very unique characteristics about these two properties. They extend farther back than typical properties on West Central. So if you see, I'm looking over here. Thank you. Okay. So I'm trying to figure out how to point out to you. I'm the second house. So what happens is 1237 is right in my backyard. It extends into my backyard because my property goes in an L shape behind it. My neighbor next door is Jenna Zook. I went over to her house today to ask her what her position was, and she said she never received a notice of this zoning request. And yet her property is less than 30 feet away from the backyard of those two properties. I did shoot a quick email to Jay Shivers asking her if he came to see us a list of who received the notices. But Janice was not available to come tonight. She said if she had had time, she would have wanted to write a letter to you in opposition, but she didn't. And she authorized me to share that with you. So we do question whether or not the whole zoning request is properly before you based on who was notified. Putting that aside, so my concern is that this property, if rezoned to commercial, might end up with a large parking lot or a building in the back. Now I realize that we could ask for an 8-foot buffer zone, but at the zoning committee meeting, Jay Shivers acknowledged that lighting and other things could well exceed, signage, whatever, could well exceed that 8-foot buffer zone. So we have a real concern of light and noise and pollution coming over into our area. So those deep lots have an effect on the residential properties. I don't know if the homeowner on the other side on Poplar received notice. Perhaps you know. So it would adversely affect the enjoyment of many of us of our property. Race 3 has a unique place in the history of El Dorado. It's unusual in that there was, I'm told, at one time, four oil barons who built grand houses there, and we happened to live in one of those houses. We're the second owner of the Fisher House. It's a beautiful prairie house that was designed by an architect who was a disciple of Frank Lloyd Wright. It's architecturally very interesting, and we always have people wanting to stop by to visit our house. Ray Street goes for three blocks before there's an intersection. And you know, even though it's called Ray Street, it's not a racetrack, but a lot of people think it is. Traffic races down that street. We have a lot of small kids on that block. And what's really great about living on Ray Street is that there's been a revitalization of that area, those three blocks, in the last several years. People have bought houses. They have fixed them up. It's looking really nice, and there's a great community spirit there. We want to continue that sense of residential neighborhood there. A lot of little kids. One of the things that you may not know, it's really hard to cross Central Avenue. If you want to cross Central Avenue to go to Grace Lutheran Church or any places on the other side, it's very difficult to cross. And adding commercial, with residential, you're going to have people coming and going less frequently than with a commercial property. With a commercial property, you're going to have a lot much more traffic coming in and coming out onto West Central, which will aggravate the problem of pedestrians trying to cross the street. On the southwest corner of Race Street, that property has a large brick pillar in the right-of-way, I assume it's been grandfathered in, that when you are in your car and you don't have the advantage of being in a pickup, that so you're seated higher up, it's hard to merge onto West Central going either direction because you have that brick pillar blocking you. And then the property on the southeast side of this of that intersection has a raised property. There's a raised brick retaining wall with and the property just higher up. So it's I worry about conflicts of traffic by putting commercial properties so close to that intersection. I think there will be an increased risk of accidents. So we would take the position that there are other zoning uses. It could be R2, maybe R3, that would be consistent with the commission having concerns about there being enough affordable housing so the people who work in El Dorado live in El Dorado. So we are opposed to doing the rezoning to commercial and would appreciate you taking the things that I have shared with you into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Zach Sundgren, and I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm here as an agent for Carol Cassidy. She's the owner of these two parcels, and I am here because of being the one that made the recommendation for her to propose this request for zoning, and just here to help answer any questions on behalf of her.
If we keep it the R1, the value is low, but if we make it C1, the value is high.
Higher, yeah. It's a desirable commercial lot. It's a 20,000 square foot lot. Part of the recommendation, the reason why we recommended it was because we have had some interest in it. We don't have a buyer secured, but we in our line of work we have people looking for affordable commercial lots. You've got the Quick Trip across the street, but I think it's $1 million property, and that's not very affordable. So I think this fits in the city's long-term plan. It's a lot that's big enough for a good commercial use, but at the same time, small enough to be affordable for somebody.
When you drive down Race, the quality of homes on Race are a lot different than the quality of homes on Poplar Street. And my concern is changing those two lots, you'll take away from Race Street. I drove down there, I actually listened to her when she was talking to the Planning Commission. And I went down there and I drove it. And her house does sit right against those two houses. And I'm kind of leaning to her, because I think you'll take away from Race Street. And unless you can do something to protect her.
Wouldn't the city have to approve any kind of site plan that goes in there?
Because those two lots go clear in her backyard, and hers is an L-shaped yard there.
Any change in zoning that abuts a residential requires a transitional buffer, screening fence, shrubs, some sort of buffer from the different zone classifications. So that would be required if something commercial in nature moved on those properties.
Couple questions, Scott. Those two lots basically break the difference between commercial and residential and down central. I mean, you have the donut shop there and everything past that is commercial, and everything east of that until you get to the churches is residential.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it sits right there on the fence. How long have those houses been vacant?
Approximately 10 years.
So they're not worth squat?
No, no, they're in disrepair.
And if they were demolished, the lots aren't big enough to build housing on, are they?
You'd have to put them together and build one.
Yeah. You'd have to put them together?
Yeah, it would have to be one structure on two lots, or some sort of creative duplex, possibly, but that would require a
zoning. That'd require a zoning change, right. Too. Mm-hmm.
What was the Planning Commission's concern?
You had three of them that were concerned about the transition from a R1 to C1 that close to the residential district. Same concerns Mrs. Strant shared tonight.
I mean, we've got one right across the street too, right?
Mm-hmm. We do. Mm-hmm.
This looks like it goes one block further east than this one does.
And one of the reasons staff is recommending approval of this is it, of course, falls within our future land use and comprehensive plan. And we have heard interest of potential development. So we know that there is a potential there that is necessarily for a value gain in the price of the lots or the sale.
So refresh my memory, and I should know this, and I don't. I apologize. What are the restrictions on C1? I mean, is that, can you have a 24-hour business there? Is it daylight business?
You can have 24 hours. Now some of the restrictions against R1 would be that buffer would be lighting. They would have to make sure that their lighting did not go into the residential zoned areas or properties. I spoke about the buffer. But C1 is just your general retail businesses. No restrictions on hours of operations necessarily. There are, you know, of course, couldn't be odors, loud noises, those sorts of things you would expect in an industrial zone. But.
So if we changed it to C1, does it become one big lot?
So it doesn't affect the lots, it just becomes the zoning of those two lots.
It'd be another issue.
Okay.
If
neither one of them are big enough to build anything commercial.
So they would be
just odd.
Yeah.
It'd be a real odd structure.
Like a shotgun.
Yeah, exactly like a shotgun.
Could the houses on Ray Street, could they buy those two lots and split them in half? The ones that face Ray Street? The ones that are in their, those lots are in their backyard, could they buy those and split them?
That would be up to the owner and the seller. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, yeah.
That'd be an owner and a buyer and seller.
Yeah.
But one thing, too, that may need to be said, and it's Judith kind of said it, was it's fairly unusual, and that may be indicative of your split vote, of a zoning change without someone, without a need. And so usually when you hear this, it's because somebody wants to do something and has a need for a change to make it happen. And in fact, you heard it right before this issue. You heard a need that generated a request. That just changing zoning, request to change zoning without a project is not as common.
Well, this really wouldn't be any different than the Legion property, which requested to be C1 so that they could be in a position to sell their land.
But they had a contract.
But that was headed towards C1 zoning regardless. I mean, that I don't know that that's the way I see this is somebody who certainly has ownership of this property. They have the right for the highest and best use of their property. Fits into our zoning regs, our future land use map. And the fact that they want to be ahead of the curve and have it available at C1 rather than offered as a, offer the property and then hopefully your project, hopefully we can get it rezoned for you. That's a different position as a seller than offering as C1 ready to go. And so I see those as different. I mean, I see this as an owner of a property who's positioning themselves for highest and best use of their land, which residential has not been that for them.
Oh, and I'm not judging it. I'm just saying, no, you don't see this very often.
I'd say that's probably true. But what's happening here is, I'm just kind of to have the discussion. What I think's happening here is to be ahead of whatever potential buyer that might be who proposes a project on the hopes that this will be zoned C1, right?
I think that if you don't pass it today, the commission's gonna hear about it again.
I think that's probably true. As soon as they have a potential buyer, then it'll be back as, now we have a buyer and let's go down this road again.
Right.
The difference is that seller, and if, I'm just kind of playing this out in my mind, the difference is that seller or those potential buyers look back and see that it was once submitted to be a zone changed and denied. So all of a sudden the property as a buyer has less appeal because there's a question on whether or not it'll get approved, right?
Contingent. I mean, just like the property on Summit, mm-hmm. there was an offer made contingent on zoning. And so again, very common mm-hmm. process, slows down a project, but it won't surprise me if other people think it's highest and best use and it's consistent with the future land use. And so I think that if you don't do it today, you will hear about it again. Maybe not in my lifetime, but
right now it doesn't make sense the way it is unless you take the Turner's property too and put it all together.
I don't think
to make a perfect square.
Actually, that may be the scenario, is that now you parlayed a bunch of property.
Yeah.
And that you're gonna do it. Because those two lots, I guess from my perspective, are gonna be hard to work with no matter what you do with them.
The houses could sit there and exist as grandfathered in a C1 district if we were to make this change and somebody moves into it.
A service company,
losing the houses really isn't as residential. Losing the structures as residential really doesn't change since they're a pre-existing use of the land. Is that right?
No, right. And so in its shape today, an attorney, an accountant could move into it and operate fairly easily in that structure.
And all correct. And in its assuming C1 approval tonight, somebody could move in there and live as well, since it's a house already sitting there.
Just be non-conforming use.
Right.
Yeah. Until something changed.
Right.
With the structure.
But they're not livable houses.
I don't know that.
We don't know that.
I have not been in them. We haven't taken a look at them.
Okay.
And just to clarify, the statement about notices not being received.
Yes, thank you. I was on my notes.
There was 16 property owners within the 200-foot buffer area of this zone change that were notified and sent letters. Mrs. Zook was one of those on there.
Okay. Did you send it certified?
Did not.
Is that typical practice to not send it certified?
It's really expensive.
Yeah.
And then when you send it certified and people have jobs, they don't always pick it up. And so we get returned
Okay, any further questions? Would entertain a motion.
B-1216.
I move to approve case number 16002 REZ, requesting the rezoning of 1237 and 1239 West Central Avenue, El Dorado, Kansas, to C1 General Business District be accepted and that ordinance G-1216 be approved.
Okay, it's been moved. Is there, we have a second? Our motion fails for lack of a second. Still need a motion.
I moved that it be denied. 1237, 1239 West Central Avenue, El Dorado, Kansas, and it stays a R1.
Scott, does that need to be, do they need action? If they don't vote on it, it stays the same. If they don't vote on it for so many days, it's viewed as a no.
6 months, I believe.
So, I mean, they really don't have to do anything, do they?
No, but to formally deny the request, it would take a majority.
It takes a majority, which we would need.
Move to send it back to the Planning Commission.
We need to have the reasoning for it. They had a 3-3, six of their, they had six.
Did they have a?
Quorum.
Had a quorum, but.
But did they have a full commission?
They had nine members on the Planning Commission.
And six were present.
Correct.
Is that a good enough reason to send it back? I thought we did that one other time. I thought we
sent. You've sent stuff back before, but I think you've got a motion on the floor.
We've got a motion to deny on
yours
the floor.
Yours failed for lack of a second.
No, you don't have to keep bringing
it. I'm just trying to be the parliamentarian.
Rub my face in it. That's all right.
We do have a motion. Do I have a second? I think this fails for lack of a second too, Greg. I will second it so we can get a vote going on this and move this forward.
You didn't second mine.
So it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? I have a question. We have a roll call vote here. It takes a majority to overrule the Planning Commission, which is tied.
You don't have to have a roll call. In this case, you only have to have a roll call if there's an ordinance, and you don't have an ordinance in this case. You move to decline the request. So it'd just be a simple yay, nay vote.
I see. My agenda had a roll call on it. That's why I was looking at that.
It because it followed the one with the motion with the ordinance in it.
Okay.
And so the... And actually, either one would take three in this case. Roll call three.
Right, vote three. So back to the same, thank you. Back to the same question is we've got a tie at the Planning Commission.
Correct.
Which is no action.
Correct.
We're either approving or denying the request here with this vote.
Correct.
And since it's a tie, we need a majority. We just need.
If you want to override a recommendation, super majority, and that's not the case.
That's not the case here.
Right.
Okay. All right. So the motion on the floor is to deny the request. It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
No. So it's tied again.
Kendra, did you vote?
It's tied two to two.
Voted to deny.
So it's
and yes, you, no, yes.
Oh, you voted
no.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm with you.
You didn't want the denial. You didn't want it. Is that what you said? Okay. So let's send it back to the planning commission.
Got one more thing we can do, right?
Send it back to the planning commission.
Now, is that a good enough reason to send it back, the fact that they only had six?
I think it is.
Well, I think it's a great reason.
I mean, and because you're 2-2, and they were 3-3, send it back and hope they get a full commission and see what if they can come to you with a recommendation.
So with our tie vote here, we need a motion to send it back to the planning commission for them to hear it again as a full commission. Okay, I'd entertain a motion for this to go back to the planning commission.
Mr. Mayor, I move to return case number 16002REZ back to the planning commission for further review.
Commissioner Badway, you'll need to state a reason in your motion, according to the rule right here.
Really? Because they had a short commission and that's it.
We'd like the full commission to vote on it. Did you get that? Is that reason enough? Okay. Would encourage our planning commissioners to attend the next meeting.
Motion and a second.
It's got a motion. I need a second.
Kendra seconded it.
Thank you. Sorry for that. So motion and second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. The motion carries 4-0.
I was going to vote nay.
I'm sorry.
3-1.
So 3-1. Motion carries 3-1.
Go ahead and say all opposed.
All opposed, same sign.
Yay.
Sorry for that. I got ahead of you. Motion carries 3-1.
I suggest you bring your neighborhood in here to the planning commission and talk to them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Give them a ride to the meeting.
Okay, next on our agenda is Confab Inc. application for property tax exemption.
Good evening, I'm Linda Jolly with Alvarado Inc. And we have received application from Confab Incorporated for a tax abatement on real property located on Lot 1, Block 1, R.J. Metcalf, 2nd Edition, and Lot 4, Block 3 of the Carly Taylor Edition to the City of El Dorado, which is commonly known as 630 North Metcalf Road. And the company will be acquiring the property for the purpose of a manufacturing facility. Prior to your public hearing, I'd like to give you a little bit of information in regard to this project. The applicant has followed our uniform policy and procedures for the adoption of a tax abatement by the City of El Dorado. And you do have, I believe in your packets, a cost-benefit analysis. The request was for the 100% abatement for 10 years. We have given you cost benefit analysis on a couple of additional options. In all cases, the cost benefit ratio is positive, and that basically means that for every dollar invested by the city, you're getting a rate of return above that investment. The applicant is in compliance with Article 11, Section 13 of the Kansas KSA 79251 and amendments thereto. And because the property is being used for manufacturing purpose, then it does meet that criteria. This is an existing business in El Dorado, and they will be using the building to expand their operation and have an intent to create 15 jobs over a period of 10 years. This job creation is very similar to what the company has been doing in the past. And we did not talk about any, but you have the opportunity to talk about payment in lieu of tax if you'd like to. And as far as we know, the business is in compliance with all city stipulations. So I think that's the overall criteria for consideration on your part. I'd be happy to answer any additional questions, and the company is here if you have more specific questions.
Linda, would you expand on the payment in lieu of tax?
The criteria does provide, if you wanted to, and a good example of this might be a recent application I saw where maybe some infrastructure was necessary as a part of a project. And rather than the company not pay for an infrastructure improvement or something they were wanting, they paid a payment in lieu of. Sometimes payment in lieu of might be a portion of the school district tax or something like that. It's an additional agreement made beyond the tax abatement itself. And it is an opportunity. And we do need to address that, whether you want to do that or not.
Okay.
Linda, have you ever heard of anyone doing that in El Dorado?
No, I've seen it done on the county level here recently, but I have not had, we've not had payment in lieu of in the 12 years I've been here.
Okay. Any other questions from the commission? Any comment from staff?
Is it 5-year or 10-year? Can you take that out? How's that going?
The statute allows for 100% up to 10 years, and you can allow anything to that level or below. So.
But the request is 400% for 10 years. The initial request
was made for 100% 10 years.
And that has a cost-benefit ratio of 1.8.
To 1, yes, it does. And when the cost benefit is calculated, it's done by a third party. This was done, and I think your reports are dated March 8th. It was done by Wichita State University Center for Economic Development and Business Research. They take into consideration the capital spend that will be made as a part of the project, any construction activities that will be incorporated in the project, as well as job creation over a period of time, the number of visitors that the business brings to the community. So that was all provided by the company. And I must say that a lot of their information is provided on historic data. So it should be very close to what we'll see happening.
We also annually audit people that are getting an abatement. Part of that's one of our functions, and so if people don't do what they say, then you get a report of that. Or if they, conversely, when they do more than they say, you get to hear about that as well. And so this building is a good example of a project that did not do what they had said to earn the abatement and was taken off of the out of the program. And so, which is the only reason you're talking about it today, or it'd still be on its 10-year abatement for when it was built. And so I feel good about this.
What's the ordinance number going to be?
Well, I think you need to do your public
hearing. Yeah, we have public hearing. To go through two. Okay.
Other questions?
Other questions of Linda? The staff at this point?
Thank you.
Okay. Next order for this would be to hold a public hearing. Is anybody from? So at this point, we'll open the meeting up for public comment, public hearing for this issue. Seeing no one approach, we'll close public hearing. Move on to discussion among the commission. I would say here, this is one of those. To me, it's this is a great story to me. This is a, Confab is a company that's been in our community for many, many years, and hope they'll be here for many more. We have offered these kind of incentives to companies coming into town. It's really quite nice to be able to do this for a company in our own community that's expanding. So with that, I'm thankful for that, and I'd support this.
I support it too.
Any further questions or comments from the commission? If not, I'd entertain a motion.
1348. Mr. Mayor, I move the ordinance S-1348, an ordinance exempting certain real property from ad valorem taxing for the purpose of economic development for the period of 10 years, not to exceed $800,000, be approved.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? We'll proceed to roll call.
Commissioner right? Lewis?
Yes.
Commissioner Badway?
Abstain.
Commissioner Wilkinson?
Yes.
Mayor Haynes?
Yes. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you.
Next on our agenda would be an IRB for Days Inn. Is there someone that wishes to speak to the history of that? Background?
I'll come back for just a second. The real experts here in the audience, two of them. But the Days Inn project, as you remember, was a new lodging facility in the business office park built beginning at the end of last year. And at that time, we did pass a resolution to determine the advisability of issuing industrial revenue bonds. The facility has opened. And 42 rooms, very nice, well-equipped rooms. The owners did a good job of meeting the needs of the people that are coming to our community that are looking for that price range of room. So all rooms have a full kitchenette, and I think that's valuable a lot of times to our workers that stay in town for a long period of time. And this evening, Kim Bell with Gilmore & Bell is here to talk to you about the additional actions that are necessary, and the property owner is still with us if you have specific questions for him.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So, Linda said, I'm Kim Bell with Gilmore & Bell in Wichita, and we're the city's bond council. This is the final action that you need to take on the Days Inn project, and that is to pass the ordinance, which actually authorizes the issuance of the bonds and authorizes the city to enter into the various financing documents that are necessary in order to issue the bonds. And those include primarily a bond agreement between the city and the company that owns the hotel and Community National Bank, which will be the owner of the bonds. And that sets forth the terms and conditions of the bond issue. And a lease agreement, whereby the city will take title to the property and lease it back to the company under a triple net lease. And the rent under that lease is equal to the debt service on the bonds. The city is acting as a conduit issuer. They have absolutely no obligation to make any principal or interest payments on the bonds. The bank is looking solely to those revenues from the hotel through that lease payment. And this does not count against your debt limit. It's not, it doesn't in any way impact your bond rating or anything else. You're acting strictly as a conduit. If the bonds are issued this year, the property will go off the tax rolls as of January 1, 2017, and that will remain for 10 years, so as long as the bonds remain outstanding. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to try and answer them.
Any questions?
You can't stump her. You can't stump her. I've seen it. That is a smart lady.
All right. Wouldn't try and do that. Not on camera, for sure. This is, like you said, the final action. This started prior to our this commission starting. So, what just as you're saying, this is the kind of the last step.
Sort of the culmination arrived. Right. The commission did indicate their intent to issue these bonds last year before construction began, and the company proceeded in reliance on that. So this is sort of bringing the project now closer.
It says we go off the tax rolls and starting January of 17, so it is on the
It's on the tax rolls now. By statute, the property goes off the tax rolls the calendar year after the year in which you issue the bonds. So it will go off the tax rolls as of January 1, 2017. Very often, companies will wait until the project is complete before they issue the bonds so that it goes off the tax rolls when it's at its full value, rather than as of January 1 of this year, it was of a limited value because it was still under construction.
Now, the industrial revenue bonds, the advantage to the property is obviously a good rate also, and it puts it in this 10-year tax.
Right, for a manufacturing facility or a warehouse facility, it's possible to grant a property tax exemption using the Kansas constitutional exemption, like we just talked about for CONFA. But for a property like a hotel, the only avenue that the governing body has to give the incentives is through industrial revenue bonds. So we have to bond finance the facility. The other advantage that the company received is we provided a sales tax exemption certificate. And so they received a sales tax exemption on construction materials and on the machinery and furniture and equipment that went into the hotel, provided that they ultimately issue the bonds. If for some reason we didn't issue the bonds, they would all owe that back sales tax. But so those are the two major incentives to the company through the issuance of the industrial revenue bonds.
Well, you answered my second question without me having to ask it, so thank you. Which had to do with the sales tax exemption. Mm-hmm. All right, I don't have anything further. Thank you very much. Anything from staff that we should add to this comment?
Ordinance number, Tabitha?
1214.
I move that ordinance number 1214 be approved, an ordinance authorizing the city of El Dorado, Kansas to issue its taxable industrial revenue bonds, Series A, 2016, Series B, 2016, Days Inn Hotel and Suites, for the purpose of the acquisition, construction, and equipping a hotel facility, and authorizing certain other documents and actions in connection therewith.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Before we vote, I would like to say thank you to the developers and welcome the Days Inn to our community. All right, roll call.
Commissioner Badway?
Yes.
Commissioner Wilkinson?
Yes.
Mayor Haynes?
Yes.
Commissioner Lewis?
Yes.
Thank you. Item seven, engine eight. That work out.
With the addition of our new aerial truck, we'll have no space for one of our other engines, engine number eight. And what we'd like to do is deed that over to the community college. They don't have a truck. They had one, but it now is unoperational. They got rid of it. And the value to us is, if we could sell it outright, would be minimal. And so it'd be our recommendation to give the truck to the community college.
And they're ready to receive it?
Yes, they are.
Are they outside?
I don't think so.
I did ask Kim, and so it's been vetted all the way to the top, and they did say that thank you if you give it to them and that they'd love to have it. I think the other benefit is it's just moving next door. And so you still have the ability to use it. I mean, if you had a need, we know where it's at.
Good example of that is two of our trucks that retired are in public works, and they've been called into action several times in the last week.
I mean, this morning you had lots of grass fires. I saw big trucks going to grass fires this morning.
Right.
And we made TV news tonight.
Okay.
Thank you.
I entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move to donate Engine 8 to the Butler County Community College for Fire Science Program.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 4-0. Thank you. this presentation, will it be posted online?
Thanks, Chief.
Yeah, maybe already. Good.
Thank you.
Not yet.
Is it on his? Have you put that, Steve? Have you put that on your website?
No, it's not on there, but I will. But
yeah, thank you. Yeah, we're good. Item number 8 on our agenda was cemetery rates. I think this is something we talked about in work session. All this information looked awfully familiar after that session. So, yes, Kevin, thank you.
Good evening, Mayor, Commissioners. I stand before you this evening to answer any questions that you may have regarding our request to increase cemetery fees at the 3 cemeteries here in El Dorado. As you noticed in the packet of information, we surveyed other cemeteries in the area and throughout the state of Kansas to determine what their fee structure currently is. We're asking to raise our fees effective May the 1st of this year. And as you'll note, the last fee increase here for the El Dorado cemeteries was in May of 2004. So we don't come before you often asking for these increases. Staff has had conversation with the local funeral directors, and they believe that our fees are too low today, and they support this change.
I noticed some of the cities, it's the same for resident or non-resident, but yet some of them are different. What do you consider a non-resident?
Well, there is a bit of gray area in this. The city manager and I have had this discussion as well. We'll make that decision based on all of the facts. If it's someone who has lived here for years, paid taxes here for years, moved away and passed away and now wants to come back to be interred here, we would probably consider that a residential fee as opposed to non-residential. Non-residential is someone that has not had any property in El Dorado for a number of years, say lives in California and decides out of the blue they want to come to El Dorado, Kansas. That would be a non-resident fee. We don't want to punish anyone who has lived here and paid taxes here for several years.
But if somebody has a plot here, regardless of where they live, is that considered resident or non-resident?
In today's world, it would be a resident fee. I don't see that changing. Again, we'll do these on a case-by-case basis.
Okay. Any other questions? Would entertain a motion.
I move to approve the proposed cemetery rate increase for the city of El Dorado, Kansas.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 4-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 9 is new business. Anybody from the commission have new business they'd like to bring in front of the commission?
I don't have any, Mr. Mayor.
I'll just say again, congratulations on your award tonight, Mayor. And although I was passed over again, I'm happy for you. So.
What is that saying?
They got long memories.
Anything?
I'm good.
I guess the one thing I have is we went out to the golf course the other day and the greens are coming along very well. I know that golf staff is excited about it, and it really, really is making a difference. My only, I guess, comment is one of those differences between doing it in-house and having a contractor do it is the leverage of, I think you have probably a little less leverage on your in-house employees than you do on a contractor in terms of fulfilling the contract. So with that, I only say that to say I hope we can make sure they have all the labor they need to get it done. It's shared throughout the city the way we had intended to do that.
One of the things that I try to do, and that the organization tries to do, is when you look at a department, they may not have that many resources. When you look at the organization, we have 150 employees, and if the commission or the need of the community is that we change what someone's primary task is or not for the benefit of the community. 150 people in the resources of the city brought to a problem can solve problems. And so we don't like silos. And so we bring resources to bear where we need to do. And so I don't think this will be any different. The biggest challenge I think on this is we need sun. We need more 80 degree days. Because I think my problem is bent grass. I mean, it wants the sun out. And so we need...
Without 30 mile an hour winds.
Right. We need that cooperation. But we'll have plenty of resources. And in fact, we have guys out, Public Works is out there right now working. So I don't know. I understand.
Yeah.
We have lots of resources.
We have a lot. That's a very public project.
Yes, it is.
And we dedicate resources to make sure it's done.
Right. And I think the kind of though to your point, when we talk about doing something internally, part of that conversation with the commission is the time frame, so that the commission's expectations and our what we're gonna do are in sync, because things come up. And so a water line breaks, a sewer line clogs, no matter our intentions, we're addressing that problem.
Yeah.
Because that's the primary need of the community. But we can put a lot of effort into projects. And I think the Prairie Trails is a great example of what can be done when the city wants to bring resources to bear, because they don't have a backhoe and don't have a bobcat and didn't have a gator.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or carts that ran, maybe. And so the city's been a good thing for Prairie Trails. And I understand, and we talk with Jason and Jason all the time.
Okay.
Well, and that's kind of one of the reasons that I continue to have Jason Huey give an oversight to make sure that Prairie Trails gets the attention it needs. And the primary resource is going to be Public Works Department, which is Jason's, where Jason works most of the time. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, again, it was impressive out there. I'm looking forward to it turning green like everybody else is.
And I haven't talked to Jason. I get the impression, well, I went out and looked last week, and it looked to me like the gravel was all in, the pea gravel. And so now, are they ready to start hauling?
I think they started hauling
sand, peat mix?
They had...
Oh, good.
When I was out there Saturday, they had... number 8 was pretty much done with its sand. Number 5 had started the sand, but they still had a couple of them that had pea gravel to go, and they were saving holes number 4 and 3 because access to heavy truck, loaded trucks didn't damage the golf course because next to road or next to the parking lot. So that sounded like a wise. Those the greens that people see the most are the ones they're doing last, just because they want to make sure the internal ones are done. And I appreciated that explanation. So.
Great. Well, okay. They'll get the resources they need.
Thank you. Anything else? All right, we'll move on to City Manager's report.
We recently received a protest petition on paving of Oak Street, and I believe Scott has more information on the status of this project.
Yes, we received a protest petition. You all initiated the project and allowed the protest period to take place. We did receive a protest back. There is two components that are required to be able to protest out of a project initiated by you all. And one is 51% of the square foot area of the properties within the improvement district, and 51% of the resident owners. so owners that reside in El Dorado. For the square footage portion, 59% of the area was against the project. For the residing owners in the city limits, 48% were against the project. So the protest petition statutorily failed because it did not meet both of the requirements.
Okay.
However, 48% of the owner sign, which would be 15 out of the 33 total properties in the improvement district, there were 19 owners that signed. So four owners signed that do not reside within the city limits. That puts a little perspective to it.
You said we initiated that. I thought there was a. I thought that was
petitioned
land. Landowner petitioned in.
There was. It was at the determination of our bond council and our internal staff discussions to bring that forward to y'all, since it was very, very close, to bring that all for you to have a discussion and actually hold a public hearing and make it a public process. And so that's the route we took.
If you would have acted on the petition, you wouldn't have had the process that you just went through. The petition was a valid petition. You could have acted on that and not had the public hearing and not had the protest opportunity. You had a valid petition. You could have taken that and voted to do it on that volition of itself. This gave the public an extra step. And we thought that was best because the petition met the statutory requirement, but just barely. So you had a valid petition. You could have acted on it. We could have not gone through this extra step. But by having you initiate it statutorily, it gave the people another chance.
So if we hadn't have done that, if we hadn't have initiated it, there would have been no
yes
protest. There would have been no protest period, correct?
Correct.
Okay. I'm cool with that.
There were four owners that previously signed the petition that signed the petition for the project and then countered and signed the protest petition.
Okay. So as it stands now, it still proceeds, right?
Correct. It'd take action from you to stop the project. You'd have to just say, staff, we don't want to do it.
I can't call it.
Yeah, no, I know you're.
I'm not
right
I'm
now.
I'm not prepared to.
We don't have to make a decision. There's not a decision. This is a report.
Yeah.
At this point, if we want to make a decision, then we can have it brought back in front of us.
And as an agenda such. Something.
And so what's going to happen now is we're going to start down that road, and we will talk about going out for bids. And so there's.
Yeah, there's plenty.
No one's showing up to build a road anytime soon.
We have to approve the bids before anything does. Any money's expended or any obligation is made.
Well, you're gonna.
You've approved us spending money
already. Right.
So.
But any change would
no
come.
No contracts.
Out.
Yeah.
Right. And so, if you decide you want to change your mind, you just got to tell us. And Scott, just as a point of reference. Don't you think the soonest that we could have workers there or a contract would be the end of the summer?
Late, yeah.
Yeah, because most people in the road business are lined up.
Yeah.
And we're lined up in the winter. So you have time if you want to change your mind.
It would be, nice for our schedule to kind of know.
Right.
And so we could schedule what we needed to work on. sooner than later, but.
Right. But you have time.
Okay. Well, it's in the venue of report right now, so we'll leave it there.
Okay.
When somebody else has another, will the commission. Okay. Anything else from the city manager's report? Okay.
I'll tell you, I just heard today, my father was selected to go on the honor flight to Washington, D.C. He's a World War II era veteran, and I will be going with him, and that will be on May 11th through the 13th or 14th, and which the 11th is his 88th birthday, and so I will be out of the office for a few days. And we're going to try to get, I have two nephews stationed on the East Coast, they're both in the Navy, and so we may have three generations of Llewellyns in Washington on this adventure, and I'm excited.
That's cool.
Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. With this, nothing further, I entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move to adjourn.
Second. Sorry.
You're
moving second. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.